Good morning, church. It's a great day to praise the Lord. Let us arise and let us worship God, sing praise unto Him. Before that, I want you to open your Bible, Psalm 4, verse 5. I'll read out to you. Offer right sacrifice and trust in the Lord. What is this right sacrifice? In David's days, included animal sacrifice by the priest in the tabernacle. Animal blood covered the sins of the one who offered the animal. There is specific rule for sacrifice. But more important to God, more important than the ceremony was offerer's attitude of submission and obedience. You can read this in 1 Samuel chapter 15 verse 22 and 23. You can pause the video and you can read that. Today, a right sacrifice. Today, we as a believer, what is a right sacrifice? Is the one that is pleasing to God is still the same. He wants our obedience and our praise before our gift. You can read this in Hebrew chapter 13 verse 15. I'll read out to you. Hebrew chapter 15, chapter 13 verse 15. It says, through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that confess His name. Offer God your sacrifice that totally obedience and heartfelt praise. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Let us pray. Thank you, Jesus, this morning, Lord, as we come into your presence. We want to praise you. We want to worship you, Lord Jesus. You are a God. We want to focus on you, Lord Jesus. Our eyes are on you, Father. Our hearts belong to you. Our minds belong to you. Everything that we are this morning, Lord, it belongs to you. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love and yours forever. Amen. Let's sing this song, Forever Give Thanks to the Lord.
The Lord, for our God and King, His love endures forever. For He is good, it's a power thing. His love endures forever. Sing praise with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever. For the light that
forever. His love endures forever. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Blessed be your name, blessed be your name, blessed be your name, blessed be your name, name above all names. Just there to worship him. Let's bless his name this morning. Let us lift up his name, name above all names. One day, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Father. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Oh, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name.
God above all the earth.
Let's worship together. Let's sing a song, be exalted. Let us together sing a song. We exalt thee. We exalt thee. We
turn back to Jesus. And he says to this universe a song. He says, I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord your healer. I sent my word and heal your disease. I am the Lord, your healer. I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord, your healer. I send my word and heal your disease. I am the Lord, your healer. You are the Lord that healeth thee. You are the Lord my healer. You sent your word and healed my disease. You are the Lord my healer. You are the Lord my healer. You are the Lord my healer. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your presence in this place, Lord. Thank you for your healing. Thank you for nation turning back to you. Thank you for the nation crying out to you, worshiping you, Lord Jesus, bowing down to you, Lord Jesus. Every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that you are the Christ, you are the Savior, and we have eternal life in Him. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. So with all that's going on around us currently, whenever we talk to anyone, whether it be our friends, our colleagues, our neighbors, all that we can hear from them is just anxiety, stress, worry, and for some it's even the fear of death due to corona. You look around, it's just corona, corona, corona everywhere. But with us Christians, it's different. We worship the true and living faithful God. And because He lives, we all live. And all of us, that is each one of us, are His disciples. Every disciple should walk in the footsteps of their master. Some walk, some don't. So today morning, we will see and learn from one such silent disciple in the Bible. Now coming to the passage in Mark, hopefully all of us have gone through that as well as the other chapters that I had requested you all to read. So coming to this chapter, we've heard of this passage a lot, whether it be in Sunday school and quite often during Good Friday sermons. But today, we will look at it a little differently. What can we learn from this life of one secret disciple? So any guesses as to who this secret disciple could be? Let's see. So a gist of the passage that you all have read through is that Jesus Christ has given his life. He's hanging on the cross. His broken, bloodshed body is lifeless. It's dead. The crowds depart. His mother Mary, John as well, leaves the scene. The soldiers are preparing to leave Calvary, that is that place where Jesus was laid on the cross. All that you can see around is a sad scene of death, of pain, of sorrow. But out of this darkness, where in Calvary, there was one man who was brave enough to identify himself at that point of time with the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you all are wondering who this man was, the name of this man is Joseph of Arimathea. And this is the same secret disciple that we are going to learn about today. It was the bravery of this Joseph of Arimathea that stands as a challenge to me as well as to you and all other believers in this age. So today, we'll be looking at three important aspects from Joseph's life. First is Joseph's character, his concealment, and Joseph's courage. And I hope we allow the characteristics of this man to speak to each one of us and challenge us in our daily walk with Christ. So coming to the very first point, as well as the first fill in the blank in your outline, that is Joseph's character. Now all the four gospels, when we read through them, it speaks about how good a person this man was, about his integrity. Now let's see what more we can learn from his character. So firstly, Joseph of Arimathea, as it says, was from a place called Arimathea. It is a city in Judea, and during the Old Testament time, the city was also called as Ramah or Ramathiazinophim. It was located 20 miles northwest of Jerusalem and was also the hometown of the prophet Samuel. The reference to this you can find in 1 Samuel chapter 1. Joseph was a wealthy man. And that is your fill in the blank. He was a wealthy man. Now it says that he purchased that garden tomb. So looking at his ability to purchase that expensive garden tomb near the city of Jerusalem itself proves how wealthy this man was. And this tomb, it says, was new. It was a new tomb. It was not reused, and a tomb made just for Joseph. If you look at the history at that point in time, usually only the very rich or the privileged could afford a tomb just for themselves. Usually whichever tombs were there would always either be reused or would be circulating within the same family members. But if you look at this garden tomb, it was meant to be solely only for Joseph. That is, Joseph was a wealthy man. Matthew 27:57 says, "Now when evening had come, there came a rich man from Arimathea." Joseph was also called a good and just man. The word good here comes from the Greek word agathos, which translates or can be interpreted to be known as brave, reliable, competent, of high quality and excellence. It also means to say to be ready. That was, Joseph was a brave, he was a reliable person, a competent person, and a person who could be trusted, in short. So you can say he was a man of integrity. You could count on him. The word just means that he was upright. That is, he was strictly honorable as well as he was honest in all that he did. He was a man who honored the word of God to the best of his ability. That is, he was a good, he was a just man. Joseph possessed a very good moral character, and he was an excellent example at that point in time. Next, Joseph was known to be an honorable counselor. The word counselor here tells us that Joseph was a member of the Sanhedrin. Now, what is the Sanhedrin? So the Jewish courts had two classes. So the Sanhedrin, you can say in today's time, was a court in the Jewish times. So there were two classes of Jewish courts, which is the Lesser Sanhedrin and the Greater Sanhedrin. The Lesser Sanhedrin had 23 judges, whereas the Greater Sanhedrin had 71 judges. Now it's known that whenever it is just stated as the Sanhedrin, it's usually referring to the Greater Sanhedrin. That is, Joseph was a member of the Greater Sanhedrin. So if you have to interpret it in today's times, you can say he was like a member of the Supreme Court. And this Sanhedrin was the supreme body ruling the Jews at that point in time. And the Sanhedrin, or the members of the Sanhedrin, possessed ultimate power in all matters of the Jewish religion as well as their social life. They were immensely powerful men. That is, Joseph himself, you can say, was an immensely powerful man. And the Sanhedrin, that is the member that Joseph was, this was the exact same body that condemned Jesus to death. That is, the Sanhedrin had condemned Jesus to death. And look, that Joseph was a part of the same Sanhedrin. Mark 15:43 says, Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, he also waited for the kingdom of God. Now it says here, honorable counselor. So what does this honorable stand for that has been given to Joseph? That means he was in a good standing, he was influential, and he was a respected member of the body of men that was present. That is, you can say that Joseph was a leader among all of the other leaders. And he was well known, he was even well respected by the Pharisees and the Sadducees at that point in time. It then says, he also waited for the kingdom of God. Waited for the kingdom of God. This is very similar. This means that Joseph, like Simeon, remember he's referred to in the beginning of the Gospels. You can also find the reference in Luke chapter 22. In Luke chapter 2 verse 22 to 28. And he was a man with genuine faith in God. So similarly to Simeon, even Joseph was waiting for the kingdom of God to come. And like I said, he was a member of the Sanhedrin. That means he was a religious Jew as well. Being a Jew, he was still waiting for the living kingdom of God. And his faith in the kingdom of God was real. He looked for it and he longed to see God. That is the Messiah. Now, if you see in that point of time, most of the Jewish leaders possessed a religion that you can say was dead. They denied God, they denied Jesus in the way they lived and the way they practiced their religion as well. We can see that so much in all the Gospels. Whereas Joseph, on the other hand, you can say, was like the real deal. He possessed a living faith and that affected the way he lived. Now, Joseph of Arimathea, like we saw right now, possessed many qualities and caused him to stand out. He is the kind of person who would have, at this point in time, maybe made a great church member, or he would be a person who would be a great friend to have, a great Christian friend to have around you to learn from. And he possessed many qualities that today we should be learning from him. He was good, he was just in the way he behaved. And maybe we could never be good and just in a way that you can say we can never be perfectly righteous, but we can definitely be good in the way we behave. We can be good in the way we treat people around us. We can be good in the way we treat our fellow church members, our neighbors, our friends. We can be just in the way we deal with the people around us. We can be honest. And we can be reliable in our work for Christ, which is a very important quality these days. And it's very rare to find as well. We can never be just within ourselves, but we can be people of integrity. So when people look at us, they can say that, oh yes, this person is an integral person. This person can be reliable upon. This person is a good man or is a good woman. And all of this is nothing but our lives being cleaned for the glory of God. So, how is our character today? And how can we learn from Joseph in implementing in our lives today? Second, we can all be like Joseph by possessing a genuine faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's exactly what made him different from the different members of the Sanhedrin, from the Pharisees, from the Sadducees. What made Joseph different was his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. He believed in God, even though he was a Jew in the Sanhedrin, in comparison with people around him who just mocked Jesus. And this is what separated him from the dead religionists that lived around him. All they had were just rituals, rules, regulations, this should be done, this should not be done. That's it. They didn't have the faith that Joseph had. Today, with all that's happening around us, with corona, with people saying that, "Arey, hum mar jayenge." But what is our faith today? Do we have faith in that living God that no, God is there for us? And that is our faith that is going to separate us from the neighbor that's staying beside you. That is the faith that is going to separate us from the friend that we are so close to. And that's exactly the faith that is going to separate us from the colleague that sits next to us, saying that probably this might be our last day in office. So, you know, with people around, people always say that good works save us. Or like they commonly call it, karma these days is going to save us. But in us, with our faith, we know that it's not just karma that is going to save us. Salvation does not come through works of righteousness. Salvation comes solely through faith in the finished work of our Lord Jesus Christ. To make it a little simpler for you, let me give you some references. Ephesians 2:8 and 9 says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast in it." Titus 3:5 says, "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit." Now looking at these two verses, we'll just run through a flow through of what salvation is for us. And you can have a look at it in your outlines. I have mentioned it in the form of a flowchart, which will be very easy for you to understand. So now salvation, like they say, is faith in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. So salvation occurs when a lost sinner or a sinful person like us is drawn to Jesus through the Holy Spirit. That sinner then is awakened or comes to realization or understands what he or she has done and comes to realization of their condition. This sinner then learns to see his sinfulness. He is then made aware of the holiness of God and the price that God demands because of sin. That sinner is then drawn to Calvary, that is, to the cross. He sees the price Jesus paid for his sins on that cross. He sees that Jesus was broken, Jesus was bleeding, he was mocked, he suffered, and he died just so that sin could be taken away from us. Then this sinner sees that his Savior is rising in power as well as in victory 3 days later. This sinner, these things that he is made to understand through Jesus Christ, alone is the way of salvation. This sinner, after being changed, after seeing what Jesus did for him, after coming to realization, looks away at his past by faith, believing the things that God did for him. And this sinner is then eternally saved, proclaiming the name of Jesus. And this, you can say, in simple terms, is biblical salvation. So when it comes to Joseph's character, we can never be exactly like Joseph. There is a vast difference between him and us. But there are a lot of things, like I mentioned, we can adopt from him. And we can implement those in our walk with Christ. Now, let's see the next part of Joseph. That is Joseph's concealment. That is your second part, fill in the blank. Joseph's concealment. Joseph of Arimathea, like I said, was a Jewish leader. But along with being a Jewish leader, he was a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. He embraced the truth that Jesus was the long-awaited Messiah that was to come and save Israel. And we've seen about his faith, we've spoken about his faith and about his character. And from all of this and from all the different passages that we read about Joseph, there are some things that are not mentioned, but we can gather and say that probably this might have happened. Like, they have never mentioned anything, but we can say that maybe Joseph had a lot of opportunities to see and hear Jesus Christ when he went about town preaching and performing miracles. Perhaps maybe the Sanhedrin might have also sent him to investigate the case of Jesus when he was speaking around. Joseph might have listened as Jesus thought about the kingdom of God and the way of salvation. Maybe even Joseph heard as Jesus spoke about the dead religions, as Jesus spoke about the Pharisees. Perhaps Joseph was even there when Jesus performed some of his miracles. There can be little doubt that even Joseph heard the testimonies of many people who were healed or who were delivered by Christ, and he might have heard this himself with his own ears. But in spite of all of this, Joseph was a believer, but he kept his faith a secret. And that is your fill in the blank. While Joseph was a believer, he yet kept his faith a secret. John 19:38 says, "And after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for the fear of the Jews." That means he was fearful about what the Jews would say, what the people around him would say, or maybe what the members of the Sanhedrin would say about his faith. So Joseph was a believer, but he was afraid of what would happen to him if the Jews found out that he was believing in the Christ. It's not mentioned for how long Joseph believed in Jesus. We don't even know how long he believed in Jesus. But one thing is that in spite of keeping his faith a secret, when Jesus was condemned to death by the Sanhedrin, Joseph opposed those efforts of the Sanhedrin. That is, he was not pally with them of putting Jesus on the cross. Luke 23:51 said, "He had not consented to their decision and deed." That is, he was not in the favor of trying Jesus. Joseph had many qualities that we could learn from him, but his failure to publicly declare his faith in Jesus Christ is definitely not one aspect that we should learn from him. And in this case, this is not something that we want to emulate from Jesus. We need to have faith, but we also need to boldly declare our faith in Christ Jesus. But sadly today, when we look around our fellow brothers and sisters, when we look around about our believer friends, as they say, there are so many believers who would probably fit the profile of Joseph, where they are so deeply undercover as believers that maybe even the CIA would not find out that they are believers. Their neighbors might not know they are believers, their friends might not know, their classmates might not know, nor will their co-workers know that this person believes in Christ or this person is a believer. Because either they are fearful or they don't want people to know about it. And if you watch their lives day in and day out, there is very little evidence that these people actually believe in Christ Jesus. And this is not how our lives are meant to be. We need to boldly proclaim, we need to have the courage that if Jesus did so much for us, we need to proclaim his name boldly and loudly to everyone around us. That doesn't mean that you go and stand in the colony with one loudspeaker and says, "Oh, I believe in Jesus." This is not the way we interpret this. But in our daily walk with Christ, in our daily walk, wherever we go, in our daily lives, there are so many ways that we can proclaim our faith and let people around us know that there's something different that we believe in. And there's something different when we serve our living God. Proverbs 29:25 says, "The fear of man brings a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord shall be safe." Fear of others is the biggest trap that Satan sets in front of us. Fear in general, not only of others but of so many different things, is the biggest problem that happens around us today, that Satan first sets in. Oh, what would they think? Oh, what would he think? What would she think? Or if I behave like this, will they say something? Will they accept me? So this is one thing that we definitely need to not get ourselves trapped into. And when Satan has the power to silence our testimony, he can even have the power to hinder the cause that Christ has in us, because we are opening the door for Satan to come in and do what he wants to do in us. But when we are not fearful of Satan, but we put God first and proclaim it boldly, we are not even giving him an entry into our lives, but we have God entered into our lives, giving God an opportunity to act what he wants to in us. And if Satan can prevent us from standing up boldly and declaring our faith, he can even prevent others from hearing the gospel from us. Therefore, faith is a trap we have to avoid at all costs. And this is your fill in the blank as well. Fear is a trap we must avoid at all costs. So if we are saved and we believe that we are disciples of Jesus, we should not be silent. We need to take our stand boldly for God. And God has saved us. We need to open our mouth. We just need to not sit them out. We need to open our mouth. We need to praise him. We need to glorify him for the Savior who died in our place. We need to be loud. We need to be vocal about our testimony, about the same person who redeemed us from our sins, maybe from hell as well, and forgave us for all that we did. We need to be quick when we honor him for all that he has done for us. We need to be thankful to him for all that he has done for us. And our testimony for him is commanded, it is expected, and it is well deserved for him. And this is another fill in the blank in your outline. Our testimony for him is commanded, it is expected, and it is well deserved. When you are sitting at home, you can also read through the passages of Psalms 107, Psalms 113, and Psalms 111, and speaking about how our testimonies need to be out there. And therefore, from Joseph's concealment, what we need to learn is, we need not be concealed. We have to boldly proclaim our faith in Jesus. In this aspect, we don't have to be like Joseph, we have to be different from Joseph of Arimathea. Now, coming to the third aspect of Joseph, is Joseph's courage. Joseph had purchased a tomb near the city of Jerusalem that he planned to be buried in one day. Like I said, this was solely just for Joseph. It was not used, it was not by any family member, but just for Joseph. Now Joseph was a wealthy man. Therefore, when he planned, or when a rich or wealthy man in those days bought a tomb just for themselves and had to be buried in that tomb after their death, these tombs or the rocks that they were carved from was to be their monument for wealth, to show how powerful or how accomplished these people were. So when Joseph purchased expensive garden tomb, it was to be his earthly monument for his wealth, his power, his accomplishments during lifetime. In short, that tomb was to declare his glory on earth. But we see that when Joseph saw Jesus dying on the cross, his priorities changed. And what the life of Jesus might not have been able to do, the death of Jesus on the cross did. We just saw about his concealment, but we will also see how he changed that concealment into courage. And as Joseph died that day, he may have made a decision that he would be silent no more about it, and that he would hide his faith no longer. And this tomb, which was probably for his glory, he then laid the Lord Jesus Christ in that tomb. Now when Jesus died, Joseph went to Pilate to ask for the body of Jesus to be buried. Now, please notice, this is one of the very important changes that we observe in compared to previously, where he doesn't even want to show his faith. Here, he goes to Pilate and tells Pilate that I want Jesus' body to be buried. And all this is while before he could boldly speak. Right now, he is boldly speaking. Previously, he wasn't. So this was a change that came about in him. And after seeing that Jesus was actually dead, Pilate gave the body to Joseph, not asking him anything. Watch him. Pilate gives Joseph the body without even asking Joseph anything. Remember, Joseph was a member of the Sanhedrin. Maybe Pilate already knew about Joseph, because they said Joseph was a powerful man. That means Pilate was aware of this man. And he gives him the body for burial. Here we can note, like I said, that he asked no further questions before giving him the body, because maybe he was part of the Sanhedrin, and Pilate already knew that. Now here we also see another important aspect, where the attitude of Joseph along with Nicodemus towards that dead body is worth noting. Look at Joseph. The way he treats the body, if you read through the passages, you'll understand that when he asks for the body, when he treats the body, he treats that body with tenderness, with care, being very careful about it. To him, at that point of time, that body was something very precious, and hence he treated it with compassion, with care, and with respect. In comparison to Pilate, the body of Jesus was just a corpse, something that needed to be disposed of, whereas for Joseph it meant a big thing. Now when Jesus died, his mother and all the women probably were not in a state to deal with that body, and maybe John was there, maybe Jesus' other brothers were there, but there is no mention of what they did to the body. Joseph took the body and dealt with it carefully. Now, as we know, the Passover was the next day. The Jews had probably already made a deal with Pilate that the bodies needed to be taken down from the cross on the very same day. You can read about that in John chapter 19. Now, the next day would be Passover. So the Jews wanted that the body should be taken down, they should be disposed of before the Passover started. And that's one of the main reasons why Pilate orders his soldiers to go and break the legs of the crucified men. Now, they break the legs because once the legs are broken, you cannot push yourself up to breathe. So when the legs are broken, you automatically cannot breathe and the person dies. So the soldiers even went there to go and check or to break the bodies of the to break the legs of the dying men. But when they came to Jesus, they realized that he was already there. And this was also the fulfillment of the prophecy where it says that the legs of Jesus would not be broken, or the bones would not be broken when Jesus was on the cross. So when the soldiers came to Jesus, they realized that he was already there. So they put a spear into his body, and that's when just water and blood came out separately. So in scientific terms, his plasma as well as his platelets had already separated and Jesus was already dead. So the text says that Joseph went in boldly to ask for the body of Jesus. Now what do you mean by went in boldly? That is, that phrase means that he walked up inside with courage. Remember, this is the same man who didn't want to be associated, or who was not boldly proclaiming that he had faith in the Lord Jesus. This is the same man who walks up in with courage to ask for the body. Not just that, he even treats the body with care in front of everyone that was there at that point in time. Now, when Joseph went for the body, even Nicodemus was there along with him. You can see that in John chapter 19. And they begin the burial preparations. Now, many commentaries say that when Nicodemus was there and when Nicodemus was helping Joseph, Nicodemus was probably influenced by the courage that Joseph showed in that point in time. And maybe they were there as a part, maybe Nicodemus as well was there as a part of the Sanhedrin to see what was happening when Jesus was being killed. But when these men came there, they maybe might have come there from the Sanhedrin. Maybe they were there to represent a dead religion. But when Jesus died on that cross, that changed. When they came there to represent a dead religion, they left back representing a living God, victorious. Similarly, each one of us today who believes and accepts that our Lord Jesus is the master of all, and when we have faith in him, we are representing a living God. It's not a small thing. It's way different. And if you look at the other people, if you look at other religions, you would know how big and grave this is. You are representing a living God. And for that, you don't need to be sitting in concealment. You need to be happy. You need to praise him. You need to glorify his name boldly and with courage. Therefore, even for people who are not acting with courage, imagine you are representing a living God. How much more courage you should be having in representing that God. Now, when Jesus died on the cross, like I mentioned, this tomb was probably the glory of Joseph, you're on earth. But when Jesus died on that cross, Joseph was no longer even concerned maybe about his glory or about his riches. He immediately went, took Jesus' body and buried it in that very same tomb which was not used previously for anyone else. And now he has declared his faith in Jesus. Not by words, maybe. He never boldly said it that, okay, I believe in Jesus and so I'm taking his body. But his actions spoke louder than his words at that point in time. And he declared his faith by asking Pilate directly for the body of Jesus. And now, when they asked Pilate for the body of Jesus, when they took Jesus down from that cross, maybe they would have passed through the city with that body when they were taking the body to the tomb. So as they prepared the body and as they placed the body in the tomb, they sealed the tomb. But one thing that we can see over here is, it must have taken a great courage for Joseph to ask Pilate for that body of Jesus. We can see a few issues that Joseph might have faced being in a position of a member of the Sanhedrin. Now, like I mentioned, when they were passing through, maybe they were passing through the city with that body, so many people might have seen them carrying the body of Jesus to the tomb. Second, as a member of the Sanhedrin, Joseph may have or could have been expelled by Pilate, who was probably angry from Joseph taking the body of Jesus, because that was the body that condemned Jesus to death. And here, Joseph, being a member of the Sanhedrin himself, goes and asks for the body. So it could have been that he would have been expelled from the Sanhedrin as well. Now, by identifying himself, Jesus was tried for treason. So when Joseph took the body, he was identifying himself with Christ. So maybe Joseph could have also been implicated as a traitor in Rome. Now, when Joseph identified himself with Jesus, like I said, he could have been expelled. He could have been treated as a traitor himself. And the common Jews or the common people that saw him taking the body may have also turned against him. Or they would have not understood what he is doing. They could have boycotted him or probably said that we don't want to identify ourselves with this man because he is with Jesus. He would have been condemned by other leaders or by other influential or privileged people at that point in time. Maybe he would have lost his money, he would have lost his position, he would have lost his privileges. And the next day was the Passover. By touching that dead body, maybe Joseph could have defiled himself and he would not be even allowed to participate in the Passover meal. So looking at all of these points, Joseph definitely stood up in courage. Looking at all of this, and maybe not by words, but by his actions, he proclaimed his faith in Jesus. It definitely costs something to be a true disciple of Jesus. It costs Joseph maybe, it even will cost us. There are certain things that we would need to change when we are true disciples of Jesus. And that is one of your fill in the blanks. It still costs something to be a true disciple of Jesus. Well, the Lord Jesus himself put it in this way. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. To be a genuine disciple of Jesus, there may be changes that we would have to make in our life. But we can be sure of one thing, that he is watching and we are not going to regret this decision. First Corinthians 6:19 and 20 says, or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God and not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. That is, all that you have is his, and therefore, you need to glorify him. And it would mean to live a life that is one step different from the world around us. And this is what the scriptures teach us, that we don't need to fear. We need to have the courage to proclaim the name of the Lord boldly. So these are the three aspects that we can learn from Joseph on how we could be a good, how we could be just, how we could be reliable in the way we are in our walks with Christ, how we need not to be fearful, but how we need to take courage in proclaiming the name of our God Jesus Christ. Now, coming to the end of this passage, maybe this passage ends on a sad note where Jesus is buried, his tomb is sealed. But we can put it in this way that, when we leave this text, we can leave with one line. It's Friday, but Sunday is coming. And Jesus is still the living God, victorious, watching over each of us every day through all our times. So in conclusion for the text today, I would like each one of us, including myself, to ponder upon certain questions on how we can improve upon. I have even mentioned the questions in your outline along with a little space for the answers. And with current times in our hand, we can always write the answers to the questions itself individually. So the question is, what kind of disciples are we? Are we vocal and bold in our witness and our testimony? Or do we tend to hold back because of fear of what others would think about us? Has God spoken to us about being bolder in our witness? Second, have we been saved? And do we know what salvation actually is? Or do we pretend like no one has ever told us about it? Or are we, like Joseph, keeping our faith a secret? We need to take a public stand. And can or do we have the courage to do that? Do we have the courage to stand up and tell the world that we believe in this living God? And if this passage has spoken to us and touched us in any specific area of our life, can we take 2 minutes to write that down on how we can be different from today? So these are the questions that we can ponder upon during the entire week. So God bless, and hopefully this has touched each one of us somewhere in our hearts. So leaving with a God bless, stay safe, stay home. Bye.
There is strength within the sorrow. There is beauty in our tears. And you meet us in our mourning with a love that casts out fear. You are working in our waiting. You're sanctifying us. When beyond our understanding, you're teaching us to trust. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. You are wisdom unimagined. Who could understand your ways? Reigning high above the heavens, reaching down in endless grace. You're the lifter of the lowly, compassionate and kind. You surround and you uphold me, and your promises are my delight. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. Your plans are still in progress. You are sovereign over us.
Saints, I pray that the love of God that He has poured into our hearts, that the Holy Spirit given to us, be with each and every one of you, particularly in these times. We pray that whatever fear, anxiety is in your heart and your mind will come to rest, because He will give you the peace of Christ that will surpass all understanding. And I pray that the fellowship and communion with the Holy Spirit be at its highest, since He has given us all the time to be in our homes, not only by ourselves, but also with many of us, with our whole families. And the people of God said, Amen.